We are back on Get Up. Dolphins Steelers Monday Night Football last night. If you missed it, quick look back, late second quarter. Steelers down 14-3, and the Dolphins flat out don't try to stop them on this play.
The tank pressure, meaning we're trying to get the first pick of the draft. We will blitz everybody, cover nobody, leave incredible amounts of yardage between a defender and a receiver, and then have terrible effort trying to make a tackle. Kind of embarrassing for the Dolphins.
Yeah, embarrassing is one word, disgraceful potentially another. Meanwhile, Steelers driving late in the third, same score, second down at the Dolphin 26. Juju Smith-Schuster.
Give me that. That's going to be on a You Got Moss segment by Randy, going up over the defender, fighting for the football, carrying it into the end zone, securing the catch. Great play by Juju.
Steelers come from 14-0 down. They win it 27-14, and without their triple Bs, Big Ben, Brown, and Bell, it has been Juju Smith-Schuster who has quietly taken control of the offense. Another 100-yard game yesterday. He has the most such games before his 23rd birthday ever. You see who previously had that record. There's Randy Moss, there's Odell, and now it is Juju on top of that list. Okay, let's go around the league. Week 9 is upon us. We are basically at the midway point of the NFL season. Look at some of the big teams in the league. The Patriots, the only team since the merger to lead the league in points allowed, takeaways, and sacks through 8 games. Meanwhile, the Niners, 7-0 for the first time since 1990, actually leading the NFL in total defense, allowing fewer than 225 yards a game. Elsewhere in the NFC, the Packers off to their best start since 2011. Matt LaFleur has energized the offense. Aaron Rodgers ranks second in the league in passing yards and touchdowns. And the Saints are also 7-1, despite playing so many games without Drew Brees. Teddy Bridgewater went 5-0 in his absence. So the question is, who's the favorite to win the Super Bowl right now, according to our football power index? Well, by a wide margin, the answer is New England, a 38% chance. Next closest, the 49ers, but you see the reason for that. The NFC is so much stronger. The path to get to the Super Bowl is obviously going to be a lot more complicated for an NFC team, it would feel like, than for an AFC team. So with us being basically at the midway point, we wanted to get a primary first half takeaway from each of our folks here up on the set. And let's start you with Orlovsky. What is your first half biggest takeaway?
Don't overlook the offensive line. We want to talk about why Baker Mayfield's getting murdered every week, because the Cleveland Browns overlooked the offensive line and how important it was. And so he's playing under duress every single week and just taking hit after hit after hit. And everyone wants to remind everybody that Aaron Rodgers is the greatest quarterback in the NFL. Well, why? Because they paid attention to their offensive line, invested into a draft pick, and now they have one of the best offensive lines in football. And the team that played in the NFC or represented the NFC in the Super Bowl last year, no one's talking about the Rams. Why? Because they overlooked their offensive line and now are no longer nearly explosive as they used to. Andrew Luck retired a week before the season. The Colts paid attention to their offensive line, and it paid dividends.
Yeah, and the reason that Andrew Luck retired is because for so long they didn't pay attention to their offensive line, and they wasted, if you will, the career of a guy who might have been one of the all-time greats. Okay, so there's one. Swagoo, what is your primary first half takeaway?
The running back position is not dead. All right. And listen, there are guys impacting football games from the backfield. Not only Christian McCaffrey and Aaron Jones, and we talk about the guys that are doing the things at a high level, but look at San Francisco as well and their scheme. Dalvin Cook obviously here. You think about these guys that are making an impact on their team, and it's not just conventional turnaround and hand the ball off. They're catching passes out of the backfield. They're implemented into the pass game now, and you look at what Shanahan is doing in San Francisco. Oh, everybody spread the ball out. Let's throw it 50 times a game. We're going to line down. We're going to see if you can buckle up and stop us
quickly
from toting the note.
Mike Tannenbaum, from a front office perspective, is the way people view the running back position changing? For the longest time there, it felt like those were just interchangeable parts. Get one, you get another. This one gets hurt, we get another guy. Don't use a high draft pick. Is that changing?
Yes, and to Swagoo's point, when you look at guys like Christian McCaffrey, Dalvin Cook, they're transformational players, so yes, that position is evolving again.
The question, however, is the durability of it, right? Like, is what we talk about quarterbacks, you can't let them get hit that many times. Cam Newton, people like that, they start wearing down. That's going to happen, too, to guys like Dalvin Cook and Christian McCaffrey and the others.
But, Greedy, you've made the suggestion before. You take that running back in the first or second round, you get the best years of their career at cost certainty. It makes a lot of sense.
They're using them so many ways now, right? This unconventional thought of running backs being their usage and the legs and all of that. Now you got these guys spread. Now they're doing a lot of different things. When I was in the league, it was run power and lead and get your running back killed until they break one. Now it's so different the way they are using these guys. It's almost evolving a little bit like the tight end position evolved over time.
All right, Mike T, what is your primary first half takeaway?
The value of the having depth at the quarterback position, and kudos to the Indianapolis Colts. Your next dad and the New Orleans Saints, you look at the law firm of Brissett and Bridgewater. Those are two teams that are still alive because they've done a great job of addressing that position. Jacoby Brissett is a good starting NFL quarterback. And you look at the New Orleans Saints, 5-0 with Teddy Bridgewater. He made a lot of money. He's positioned himself to be an unrestricted free agent, and he'll do well in the market.
But Dan Graziano, let's talk about those quarterback injuries.
And look, I'll add Carolina, right? Kyle Allen, they won four straight games with him after Cam Newton got hurt. And I was talking to their GM last week, Marty Herney, about the idea of that backup quarterback position. And he said, you know, the studies are showing them that developing your own is the way to go, right? So Jacoby Brissett was ready to go and play in Frank Reich's system right away. Kyle Allen's a guy that Carolina had put some, you know, resources into. They were invested in him. So I find that Bridgewater a little different case, although he was in New Orleans all of last year as well. So not only just, you know, go find a good backup quarterback, but almost in some ways sort of make sure you make one.
And then every once in a while you get super lucky and Gardner Minshew winds up being on your bench when you desperately need him. And the next thing you know, everyone in the football world is wearing a mustache.
Minshew.
All right, that's our pro story for the moment. Elle, take us to school.
Let's do it. College football, Michigan, of course, bludgeoned Notre Dame for 303 yards on the ground and a 45-14 rout on Saturday in Ann Arbor. So for at least 1 week, the pressure and scrutiny shifted away from Jim Harbaugh and, well, really back onto the original Jim Harbaugh, Brian Kelly, because let's be honest, I think Harbaugh is kind of like a starter kit for him. You take a look at the rest of the schedule for Notre Dame. They can certainly turn things around and potentially make a New Year's Six Bowl, and that's because they're heavy favorites in every one of their remaining schedules. And, well, you take a look at that and you see why. PU, I'm just saying. It's not great. Paul Finebaum, what do you make of Brian Kelly at Notre Dame?
He's good, not great. He's never going to win a national championship. And the wise move, L, for Notre Dame is to buy Brian Kelly out.
Ooh.
Okay.
And bring in Urban Meyer. Urban Meyer is the best available coach in the country. He wanted to go to Notre Dame 13 years ago. Florida got him instead. There are a lot of reasons why that may have happened. But Notre Dame is a national championship caliber program, but Brian Kelly is not a national championship caliber coach. He lost by 28 in a national championship game. He lost by 27 last year to Clemson. He inexplicably lost to Notre Dame by 8,000 points on Saturday night. And on top of all that, Marcus, he's not a coach that is going to be a magnet to bring in great players.
I mean, I'm so much bigger than you sitting in this seat, by the way.
I love this.
It is a beautiful
picture.
They have
to pan out.
But when you give a takes like that, you raise way above me. But you have a point, right? What was the conversation? The conversation revolving around Brian Kelly was the same one revolving around Harbaugh. Can't win the big ones, right? And these type of programs, this is a different position they're in. These type of programs are predicated on winning big games. Everybody talks about, oh, he won 9-10 games. It's the ones you win are the important ones. And for him to show up twice, well, one in the college football playoff and then the national championship, and they end up being beat like that.
But basically, this isn't Alabama. Like, Notre Dame's notorious for losing the big game even before Brian Kelly got there.
But don't forget, 3 years ago after he had a losing season, we heard that impassioned speech by Brian Kelly. This is different. We're going to change the culture here. We're going to do things different. And then he gets blown out last year by Clemson. There's no faith. I mean, if you're a recruit out there, and unless you're a Notre Dame person, a legacy, why would you go there? Why would you play for Brian Kelly and be good and not great when you can go to Clemson, Alabama,
and imagine
all these other schools?
Like, he was in the playoff last year.
Correct.
So he was National Coach of the Year last year.
It's really, college football is turning into where are you headed? Has more to do with where you are right now. And for Brian Kelly, it looked like it's stagnant.
He certainly had plenty of time there. He's been there for the better part.
He's been there 10 years.
He's been there for a better
part. Give him a gold watch and thank him.
A gold watch and be on your way. And we good.
You so little.
More with Paul coming up in just a bit. But still ahead here on Get Up.